Since his very beginnings, man has had a compulsion to test the limits of his horizons, always challenging the next mountain range or trying to navigate a vaster sea. But that challenge of rising above the earth, to sail through the air under his own power, escape the clutches of gravity, was one that defied him until the turn of this century. And when he finally made it, using a tiny gasoline engine to drive a flimsy framework of spruce sticks covered with hand-stitched linen, he was to change the face of the globe. And of all the nations who've fallen in love with aviation, perhaps none has been more transformed by its passion than our country. The promise of flight tantalized mankind through the many dark nights of the centuries. I don't know how many millions of school children learned and probably forgot the legend of Icarus, who flew too close to the sun and then had the wax melted from his feathers that held together his man-made wings. Then there was Leonardo da Vinci, who solved that problem with an ingenious ornithopter with flapping wings of wood and leather. And the Englishman, Sir George Cayley. His designs from almost two centuries ago look remarkably contemporary today. And the other visionaries, among them the stout Lilienthal, the German proponent of gliding. But it was left to two Parisian papermakers, the brothers Montgolfier, to demonstrate that getting airborne was both practical and safe. They didn't fly exactly, they floated, using hot air to fill and consequently to lift their balloon. And that's how the air age came to Canada. Here in this Montreal marketplace, a Frenchman named Eugène Godard made history by constructing a big balloon in the Bon Secours Market building. He called the balloon the Canada. He filled it with gas from a convenient nearby gasworks. And that balloon on September, don't remember the exact date, September 1856, made a spectacular ascension carrying three passengers.
Naturally, Montrealers were astonished by this feat. Conveniently, they forgot that the first balloon ascension ever in Canada had happened 16 years earlier in the Maritimes at St. John, New Brunswick. All the same, new horizons beckoned.
Jean Cocteau wrote, "The more man can enlarge the frontiers of mystery, the better his health of mind." The voyage into this new frontier, this sky ocean, is a matter of thousands of years of joy and frustration, sorrow and triumph. And all the accumulated knowledge logged on those centuries of earthbound voyages finally brought man here, these desolate dunes of North Carolina. And one of those moments that changes the direction of history. Wilbur and Orville Wright's particular voyage of exploration wasn't a long one, 9 years since they began to study the plate. The Wright brothers' style belies the image of greatness. And yet history knows they were extraordinary men.
Orville was small, dark, and dapper. Not, I think, so attractive as Wilbur, who was tall, gangling, and very seldom spoke unnecessary words. They were both extremely humble, and I do wish this stupid story about them being sort of hicks. The Americans love the old story, you know, sort of from rags to riches, from farm boy to genius. They were geniuses when they started, they were very highly educated, and they remained so. Right through their lives.
The Wrights have been described as learned, exact in their thinking, and outstanding experimenters. And it's perfectly clear that they were very hard workers, too, building bicycles in this shop beside the family home in Dayton, Ohio. It doesn't really seem significant now, but around the turn of the century, the bicycle builder was riding the crest of the transportation industry.
The bicycle was the emancipation of mankind upon wheels. It made it possible for a person to get on these wheels and go where he wished, something he'd never been able to do before.
In those mid-1890s, the Wrights seemed to be obsessed, almost consumed with work, because in addition to building bicycles and sitting here at this desk doing their accounts, answering their mail, they were also collecting, analyzing, cataloging every scrap of information they could find. It didn't matter how wild it was, as long as it dealt with flight. By 1899, their studies had led to the design and building and test flying of a 5-foot wingspan biplane on a tether. It was really a kite. And then 4 years later, in 1903, they were actually piloting their own glider, their third. One flight lasted a magnificent 26 seconds. To test out their theories of aerodynamics, they built their own design, a wind tunnel. They became convinced that they could build a machine that would propel itself through the air if only they could get the power plant. Car engines at the time were just too heavy. So characteristically, the Wrights began to design and experiment and test to develop their own engine. This is a quarter scale model of it. The original weighed 200 pounds, was liquid cooled, and developed 12 horsepower. Now, propellers were a terrific problem, because even though the windmill had been around since about the 13th century, nobody really understood about air screws. And so again, characteristically, the Wright brothers designed, experimented, tested, developed their own propellers. This one powered the wind tunnel. As 1903 came to a close, the Wright brothers would be back here at the Killdevil sand dunes, buffeted by a wild wind and haunted by the words of Jules Verne, who had written, "It's not worthwhile conquering space unless we can devour it." On the morning of December 17th, 1903, Wilbur and Orville Wright would feast at the table of success. And a group of bystanders were awestruck, all five of them.
It was a very cold day and a very windy day. The Weather Bureau indications were for a headwind, wind from the north, of 24 miles per hour. That's a lot of wind to try to fly in when no one has ever flown before.
They made four attempts. The first one lasted 12 seconds. And the fourth one, which Wilbur flew that morning, covered nearly half a mile through the air, 852 feet over the ground, and lasted for 59 seconds. That air duration was not equaled by anybody in Europe until 1907. They were yards ahead of everybody, even on that cold morning of December 17th.
First time in the history of the world that a machine heavier than air and carrying a man had risen from the ground under its own power, had flown forward under control, and landed without wreckage at a point equally as high as that from which it had risen. And when you read these other claims by persons who said they flew before the Wright brothers, let them put their claim through the sieve of that definition, and they'll find that they may have bounced, but they didn't really fly.
The Wrights' great contribution to flying, apart from the fact that they were the first, and the first undoubtedly to get into the air and fly, was in air control. That they were the first people who made and perfected three-axis control.
Three-axis control, that was the elusive secret. The early aircraft pioneers understood very well that an aircraft moves around three axes, rolls around its longitudinal axis,
yaws around its vertical axis and pitches around its lateral axis. But the problem was how to control those movements. And the great achievement of the Wright brothers was in that first airplane, which they constructed right here in this shop I'm standing in. They incorporated controls to handle those three movements, even though they were rather primitive controls. In a modern airplane, those controls are handled by surfaces like these, ailerons on the trailing edges of the wing to control the roll around the longitudinal axis. The rudder to control the yaw around the vertical axis. And the elevators to control the pitch around the lateral axis. By 1905, the Wrights built their Flyer III, incorporating these refinements, and offered it to the United States government, who showed little, if any, interest.
When the Wright brothers, after their marvelous 24-mile flight of 1905, wrote to the War Department and offered to give demonstrations, the War Department just sent them this form letter. And then when they asked their congressman, the congressman got a copy of the same form letter, and the Wright brothers were quite disappointed.
These ridiculous people, and they're as ridiculous in this country and in Canada and in America, all these old government servants were so stupid. And they were so furious then that they said, we've done our duty, we've offered it to our nation, that they simply play clowns with us. And that's why they offered it abroad.
France was interested, and so was England, and so was Germany. The demonstrations to the world at large occurred abroad.
It seemed natural enough that in August 1908, Wilbur Wright found himself in France giving demonstrations. Wright got a skeptical reception, but not for long.
All these French pioneers who really loathed the idea of anybody having flown before them and simply wouldn't believe it, they all congregated in this little hick race course at Hunaudière near Le Mans. And they literally, they collapsed in tears, these funny old Frenchmen in their straw boaters and their liquor bottles, all streaming tears, when they saw Wilbur take off very beautifully from his catapult launching rail, make two complete circles, banking properly, of course, in the circles, and land.
During those early days of the Wright successes, there was a genius at work in Canada. Alex Bell was turning his attention from the telephone to another area of investigation, man carrying kites. And during the summer of 1907, he invited two young engineering graduates from the University of Toronto to join him, John McCurdy and F.W. Casey Baldwin. And they were joined, too, by an American lieutenant from the Army, Tom Selfridge, and another American, Glenn Curtis.
Well, Curtis was not a basic original inventor. He started as an engine man, and he was immensely important in the history of flying. Don't let's forget that. Nasty man as he was a nasty man. He was a great adapter. He was not a great conceptual thinker like the Wrights and the other great inventors.
By the fall of 1907, Bell and his enthusiastic helpers had formed what they called the Aerial Experiment Association. Mrs. Bell was the president. And the group had one stated objective: to build a, quote, flying machine driven through the air by its own power and carrying a man. At the end of the year, Bell left his study at Bedeck and moved the group to Hammondsport, New York, because Glenn Curtis had a factory in Hammondsport manufacturing motorcycles and engines. Hammondsport lies in a tranquil wine-growing valley, and in this old barn, in 1908, the Bell team produced, starting from scratch, four successful aircraft: the Red Wing, the White Wing, the June Bug, and the Silver Dart. Frighteningly flimsy by today's standards, and yet, in 1908, it was sophisticated. Tricycle undercarriage, like any modern airplane, tapered wings, the essential aileron. After a test flight at Hammondsport, Silver Dart was dismantled and shipped to Nova Scotia, to Bedeck, where on February 23rd, 1909, entered the air age. with all its impalpable perils. The flight took place from the frozen surface of Lake Brador in the hills of Cape Breton Island. John McCurdy, just 22 years old, climbed behind the controls and lifted the Silver Dart into the air, the first successful flight of a heavier-than-air machine in Canada.
After a run of about 100 feet, took to the air. I landed on the ice about half a mile away, and the thing that impressed me most was the look of absolute astonishment on the faces of the spectators.
The real truth is that they could not have succeeded had not Selfridge written to the Wright brothers and found out from them titles of their various papers which gave the secret of rail control.
There's not much flying around the Brador Lakes these days. That first flight of McCurdy's was dutifully recorded, filed away, and then virtually forgotten by all but a few aviation enthusiasts. And there was a tragic note to the work of the association even that winter. Young Selfridge was no longer with them. He lay buried in a grave in Virginia, where he was killed the previous September flying with Orville Wright in a demonstration flight for the United States Army. He had earned the sad distinction of being the world's first fatality in a heavier-than-air machine. That historic first flight of the Silver Dart didn't go entirely unnoticed in the Parliament of Canada. A month after the event, a Conservative member, Mr. Sam Hughes from Victoria and Halliburton, got up in the House to ask whether the government has taken any steps to recognize the advance of this science in Canada. And he was replied to by the Honorable Douglas Fielding, who was Minister of Finance in the Liberal government of Sir Wilfrid Laurier. Fielding said, "We have taken steps to draw the attention of the Imperial government in the hope that they may be able to avail themselves of the services of these young Canadians and thus retain them for the benefit of empire." Well, it was clear that the AEA was not getting very much official notice, but an unsung hero emerged. G.S. Monsell, an Army Lieutenant Engineering Services at Militia Headquarters, was impressed, indeed fascinated, by McCurdy's record flight. Well, Monsell got government approval for McCurdy and Baldwin to stage a demonstration. It couldn't have been worse.
But it is true that Silver Dart and the Bedeck did unfortunately crack up. I say unfortunately because it confirmed the prejudices of the rather stodgy types who, somewhat against their will, had been persuaded to come out and witness this experiment. It convinced them, it convinced the Deputy Minister of Militia, that there was really nothing in this aviation business. And I think it's really too much to expect of men who had been born and raised in the Canada of the 19th century to shift suddenly and very flexibly into the air age.
The trials almost proved fatal to Canadian military aviation are duly recorded here, just a few yards from where they took place at Camp Petawawa. They tell how the Silver Dart crashed after its fifth flight and was destroyed, and how the sister ship, Bedeck No. 1, crashed a few days later on unlucky 13th of August, and the trials were terminated. The Canadian Army now finds the terrain more suitable for track vehicles. And what's curious is that just a few days before the Petawawa trials, there was a sensational flight in Europe. A Frenchman with an enormous appetite for food and adventure. Louis Blériot had startled the world by flying across the English Channel. To the French, it was a triumph. To Britons, it was the sudden realization that Britannia's rule of the waves was no longer protection enough against unseen enemies.
His flight over the Channel took place on the 25th of July, 1909. And this must always be taken along with the great meeting, the first aerial meeting of any size in the world, which took place in August in Reims in France. These two events were absolutely pivotal in the history of the world, not just of flying, because Blériot won the headlines because, of course, he flew over water and all the wiser heads of government suddenly realized, with mind-chilling statements that were made, that water was now no longer in control of warships. He flew the channel early in the morning of a Sunday when everybody was asleep. And the papers, not unnaturally, said, supposing there were 1,000 barriers, you could have an army of 1,000 before the Englishmen woke up in the morning, all landing in the fields of Kent and Sussex. This really kicked the politicians very, very hard indeed. The whole thing was changed overnight.
In the wake of the Blériot flight, a kind of flying fever seemed to grab this country suddenly. Most of the experimenting was done under the open skies of Western Canada. In Underwood, Saskatchewan, the Underwood brothers, John, George, and Elmer, built a flying saucer, but it needed a rope looped around a fence post to get it into the air. In Davidson, Saskatchewan, the Pepper brothers took a year to build a biplane. They got it to fly 30 feet before it crashed. And on the West Coast, William Gibson of Victoria built Canada's first airplane engine, a six-cylinder affair that lifted the Gibson twin plane into the air in September 1910. The spirit of that part of the air age and the mood of the times were pretty well caught in the words of one of the early flying pioneers, Eugene B. Ely, who's credited with coining the word barnstorming. "Give me enough power," Ely said, "and I'll fly a barn door." Ely was an American.
Pilots at that time were all looked on as sort of a suicidal bunch. They weren't supposed to be sensible people at all, anybody that wanted to fly.
First of all, they had to be men with a lot of strength of character, a lot of courage, because, of course, nobody really knew anything about flying. The airplanes themselves do not fly like a modern-day airplane. As I say, the difference between stall and cruise speed is very small. And, of course, they knew nothing about spin, so they never entered a spin. They were on their way to the great beyond. Another factor which was not very pleasant, which is one of the reasons why you see some of the airplanes with where the pilot offset the engine, was that usually in any crash, particularly into any object that they hit, the engine wiped the pilot out. It just jumped right out of its mounts, and being a great big heavy water-cooled affair, just flattened them like a pancake.
Barnstorm. It was a profitable business, if you lived long enough to collect. And one man who did was a canny New England aviator named Charles F. Willard, who was the first man to give a public flying exhibition in Canada, on Scarborough Beach, right here on the shore of Lake Ontario. That was in September 1909. Willard took off from a spot over behind those apartment buildings where there used to be a fairgrounds, crossed over the beach, out over the lake, and then crashed. And he's still alive to talk about it.
There was only about 100 yards in the circle, and how I was supposed to get up and fly over the buildings to get out had me stopped. My mechanic saw me and come running over, and he says, "Don't worry, boss," he says, "you can fly out between those two buildings, that's out there to the lake," he says, "and you'll have 3 feet to clear between the wings and the buildings." That's how much everybody knew about flying. Anyway, I took off. And after I went through the buildings, I had maybe 50 feet, not over 50 feet, until I was going out over the breakwater. I knew the machine had settled a little. I was sensitive enough to the thing by that time, but I didn't dare to move the controls any, because I also knew that if I pulled the control back trying to get up in a hurry, that I'd stall it some more. It only had 20 horsepower, and that it was all too little to do any monkeying around. So while I was pondering in these few seconds, I was getting out well over the lake. And the first thing I knew, the front wheel went into the water and I went out over the front control. And the plane stood up on its nose and went down. And I sat there and the water came up to my knees and pretty soon it was up to my watch. Pretty soon it was up to my chin. And I stood up and I was long enough standing up. That's how deep it was.
Well, I pulled the airplane out, dried it off, tried it again, same result. Tried it a third time, same result. It was pretty big stuff. He was competing with Commander Robert Peary for headlines. Peary had just made it to the North Pole. But after that third crash landing in the lake, Willard had had enough. He packed up and went home.
I had a great piece of publicity which has stuck to me ever since. Willard went up. Willard went down. Willard got wet. Willard went home.
Those days, the days that we're recreating here, are days when one man held his destiny in his hands. They were daring, brave, and they must have been light-hearted men to do the things that they did.
For the most part, airplanes in those days were rarely taken as a serious revolutionary form of transportation. Far from the shores of Lake Ontario, a German aristocrat sensed the military potential of air power. His name was Zeppelin. 2 months after Mr. Willard was amusing Torontonians, Count von Zeppelin formed a passenger airline service with headquarters in this ducal town of Friedrichshafen on the shores of Lake Constance that separates Germany and Switzerland. Zeppelin had flown his first giant airship 9 years previously, in 1900, over this pastoral countryside.
He was obsessed with this idea. He had the big dream of the giant airship, which nobody had dared really to conceive or think about, with the exception of a few obscure inventors. He saw this particularly as being a weapon of aerial superiority for his fatherland in a future war.
Between 1911 and 1914, the Zeppelins Victoria Louise and others transported over 9,000 paying passengers. Although the German army at the time doubted its military role, the Zeppelins, in 2 years, would change the face of war all time, becoming the world's first strategic bombers.
On the eve of war, Canada's air policy was as empty as our skies. And this man, Colonel Sam Hughes, Minister of Militia and Defense, a bombastic, flamboyant, bull-headed, stubborn man, was to say, literally just days after the guns of August had begun to sound out in Europe, the airplane will never play a part in so serious a business as the defense of a nation.
He seems to have taken a Scunner to aircraft just out of sheer conservatism, a refusal to accept that these flimsy contraptions could possibly contribute anything to what he knew of war. What he knew of war was the South African War. And in the South African War, of course, cavalry, the key arm for scouting and reconnaissance. And I think the descent was largely a matter of the infantryman and the mounted soldier. To him, an aircraft, well, he said it at one time, was an invention of the devil.
I don't know whether you remember a frightfully funny sentence in one of the great histories of the war in the air, that it was always felt that the cavalry objected strongly to the flying machine because it frightened their horses, which was a remark.
And on that note, Canada's officers and gentlemen prepared for war, an adventure of men and horses and their grooms. Life in Canada in 1914 reflected that Victorian chivalry. The wartime garden parties flourished. It was a graceful way to get the men out of mufti and into khaki twill. C.
So off they tramped, perhaps with Kipling a shadow in their ranks. 4 points on a 90-mile square, with a helio winking like fun in the sun. As the country mobilized, suddenly and inexplicably, Sam Hughes changed his mind. There would be an Air Force. He assigned a man named Ernest Janney from Guelph and instructed him to buy an airplane forthwith.
The only document establishing the Canadian Aviation Corps is a short two-line authorization for Janney to be appointed to a captaincy in the Canadian Aviation Corps and to purchase an aircraft for the Corps. And this is signed underneath with Hughes's usual flourish, OK, SH, and that's it.
The purchase of Canada's first official airplane may be allegoric of our subsequent behavior in trade and commerce. It was designed by the British, built by the Americans, and bought secondhand because there weren't any other takers. It was called the Burgess Dunn, and its shape was arrived at after its designer had conducted tests forcing air through pipe joints. And the story of its flight across the border is a comedy of errors.
The Canadians were afraid that we might be German, yeah. At the time, there was quite a bit of spy scare in Canada. And so anything that much out of the way, is a plane coming in from the United States, needed explanation.
It was October the 1st, 1914, when Pilot Webster and Captain Janney finally landed the Burgess Dunn here in the harbor at Quebec City. And there was speculation at the time that if the trip had gone on very much longer, the airplane might well have fallen apart before they could dismantle it off to Britain. Anyway, it was loaded aboard the Athenia and headed off towards Salisbury Plain, which was the destination of that first hastily formed Canadian Expeditionary Force.
Very soon afterwards, it was determined that the minister was really no longer interested in aviation. The poor old Burgess Dunn lay around on Salisbury Plain for some time in various parts.
More or less knocked down, stood in a shed for the balance of the war, and after that it was destroyed. It was never flown after it got to England.
And that, unhappily, is the end of Canada's first Air Force.
By the end of 1914, Canada was still without an air service of any kind. Strategy revolved around forming battalions, not squadrons.
It is easy to criticize Borden for his attitude towards the air. And yet, one must have some sense of proportion here. Borden himself didn't possibly have time to become knowledgeable about every aspect of technical military matters. As it was, I think he did extraordinarily well. But on air questions, he was really subject to the kind of advice he received.
The kind of advice Borden was getting came from Major General Willoughby Watkin of the British Army, and Admiral Kingsmill, our first naval chief of staff, who'd been in the Royal Navy. Now, an admiral and a general could hardly be expected to be sympathetic to the idea of a Canadian Air Force. So in 1915, all flying instruction was in private hands. There were two schools, one out on the West Coast and one here on the Toronto Island, and this one was operated by that ubiquitous American, Glenn Curtis. He'd hired as his manager young John McCurdy, and McCurdy, with a kind of missionary zeal, managed to persuade the Canadian government to put up funds to train Canadian pilots for the British Admiralty. They used flying boats built by Glenn Curtis, and this first training took place in these quiet lagoons of the Toronto Harbor. Now remember, these young pilots were civilians. They'd given an undertaking that once they got their wings, they would enlist either in the Royal Naval Air Service or the Royal Flying Corps. They were young, exuberant, and trusting.
The Royal Naval Air Service paid us $400 a student, and we were supposed to give up to 400 minutes of training. If our instructors decided that a man was capable of soloing before the 400 minutes. He soloed them. When he soloed, he stayed on the ground from that point on, as far as we were concerned. And we got our $400.
What they're doing in those early days in Toronto has a kind of marvelous Tom Swiftian character. There is an exhilaration here. There's a sense of doing something that no Canadian or few Canadians have ever done before. These young men are at the dawn of the air age, fully conscious of it and just delight.
In 1915, the Royal Flying Corps became seriously interested in Canadian pilots. Now, that meant land-based training. So Glenn Curtis abandoned his flying boat program down at the island, moved his operations west of Toronto to Long Branch, where this hydro station is. Canada's first aerodrome, as it was called. And it tested not only the skill of its young pilots, but also their courage.
They were fearless. They had to be to fly those old crates, and they were old crates. The fields were bumpy, there were no runways or anything of the sort.
The Curtis School turned out 130 pilots, of whom 128 ended up flying overseas. They were all desperately needed. The toll on the Western Front was heavy. The demand for replacement pilots was urgent. The British and Canadian governments solved the crisis in a way that was uncharacteristic of the times. The Canadian government bought out the Curtis Flying School and the Curtis Airplane Factory and began manufacturing aircraft under the name of Canadian Aeroplanes Limited. The British government agreed to set up a Royal Flying Corps training scheme in Canada, using our first mass-produced aircraft. It was anomalous, to say the least. Here, in the early days of 1917, there had appeared a British military enclave in the middle of Canada, a country that thought it had become autonomous.
This is the airplane that came rolling off those assembly lines by the thousands, Curtis JN-4, affectionately known as the Jenny. I think it was affectionate. In any case, for an immense number of pilots. This was the beginning of a love affair that would last almost 60 years, and that's a passionate affair.
The stick is really a baseball bat, is the best way to describe it, and it's a good thing it is, because you have to put so much pressure against it that if it was anything less in size, you'd probably break it.
They were all JN-4s built in Canada at the airplane factory in Toronto. They employed a vast number of people, civilians, to build them, and they turned out beautiful work. They got some of the top artists, like piano makers and people like that, that really put their heart and soul into building them. They were beautiful aircraft.
They got exempted from the draft. We had our pick of anybody in the Toronto area that could be a mechanic of that nature.
10,000 Jennies were built during 1917 and 18, and shortly after war's end, in both Canada and the United States. By the thousands, young Canadians learned to fly them in an organization known as the Royal Flying Corps in Canada.
This was a large-scale military organization run from headquarters in Church Street in Toronto, with a ground school at the University of Toronto, housed at the University of Toronto, and with flying fields at Camp Borden, two near Deseronto, two in North Toronto, Leaside and Armour Heights, another one at Beansville, a large staff organization to run the operation, very large ground support force. And in effect, you get what is the prototype for the massive British Commonwealth air training scheme in the Second War.
This is one First World War training field that survived the passage of time looking, I suspect, pretty much as it did in 1917, except for that group of poplars there pushing up in the middle of what was the takeoff run. This is the Deseronto field. And it was from converted Ontario pastures like this one that a new breed of warrior was wrought.
When I applied for entry in the Air Force, I was a sergeant in the Canadian Army, and they interviewed me and they said, "Did you ever sail a boat?" "Yes." "Did you ever ride a bicycle?" "Yes." "Well, you can fly."
"Well, you flew before they turned you loose. The instructors are set in the back seat, you know what I mean. But those Jennies, if it had been anything but an old JN-4, you know, the Canadian, there'd have been dozens and dozens more killed. You really had to crack hard to crack them up.
They were heavy, but they had to be strong and sturdy for the banging around they got with young fellas being taught to fly. Well, some of the things that pilots did, especially the instructors, were almost beyond imagination.
At first, there's no communication at all. You get in the plane, the instructors say, "Now, when I kick the seat twice, you take hold of the stick and try and keep it straight ahead, using what we've told you, how it works and so on. Then when I kick it once, leave go. Let go and leave go fast. And for God's sake, don't freeze on the stick."
Each pilot had to carry a billy club in his cockpit with him to knock the guy out if he froze, his student out if he froze on his controls, which several of them did.
I said, "It's a cinch." He said, "All right, you take it." Now this is on the second time up. Well, I couldn't stay on that road. I'd go over the left, over the right, over the left. Pretty soon, he hit me on the back of the head. See, we wore big helmets. He let me have one over the back of the head, knocked my helmet down over my goggles and my face, and he was screaming at me, taking the control. I turned around, he saw I couldn't see. You know what I mean? So he calmed down a little bit.
In the autumn of 1917, a new element was added to the flying training. Some would say chaos. Almost overnight, moving north from the border, there appeared 300 eager Americans.
There were, by British Army standards, a very unruly lot. I was a very, very good crap shooter, and we were teaching a lot of the young English cadets up there how American crap games, and of course it was a paying business.
With the arrival of the Americans, training intensified. The goal was a singular one, to teach the students in the shortest time possible how to fly.
After breakfast, you went down to the aerodrome, to the hangar you were assigned to, and stood around, and instructors would eventually show up, and each one would grab a cadet and say, "How much time you got in?" and tell him, and then he'd say, "All right, come on up, we'll give you another half hour." So you had to, because they had so many of the Canadian boys going through, and the American boys, they had something like 4 to 6 weeks to make pilots out of them. Aviation men, army men, military men, pilots. And the Canadians did.
And so 6 hours was about the average. Some would take a little more, some less. When the instructor thought the man was ready, he'd send him solo. And you never knew when you were going. You'd go up for that morning and the world would be beautiful, and the next thing you knew, you were going to be sent solo.
By November 1917, instructors, students, and ground crews headed for Texas. In exchange for training the Americans, the Royal Flying Corps got the use of fields around Fort Worth for winter flying, an event that would tremendously influence the history of U.S. aviation.
A great many of the people who were trained in the scheme later become high-ranking officers in the American Air Force. One of them was, in fact, James Forrestal, who became Secretary of the Navy. Another was Major Hap Arnold, was up here. He later becomes General of the Armies in the U.S. Air Force.
The Canadians furnished the
initiative of the U.S. Air Force. They were the original instructor.
It is curious to reflect that the origins of the mighty American Air Arm are in part, anyway, to be found in a training scheme being carried on in Toronto and Camp Borden and Beamsville and Deseronto.
Over 2,500 students won their wings in the Royal Flying Corps scheme. But it was costly, and over 2,000 Jennies were destroyed in flying mishaps. In the summer of 1918, in a period of 3 weeks, 19 airmen were killed at Camp Borden alone. Before war's end, 25,000 Canadians were serving either in the Royal Flying Corps or the Royal Naval Air Service. 25% of all officers in the British Air Services. History's most vivid portraits, rightly or wrongly, were of the fighter pilots.
It was almost a matter of so-called knights of the air. In a way, it was perhaps the best aspect of World War I, in if you look at it spiritually, if you like to call it that.
Well, you classify it almost as a sport, rather a deadly one, but it was that sort of a way, but deadly in 1916, as everyone knows, and from then on, of course, it was every man for himself.
I have a picture lying in here of Quentin Roosevelt that it did, and the second time over the line, he got lost, and they knocked him down. I've got his picture of his body lying in here beside the plane, Theodore Roosevelt's son. If they get on your tail, you're in a bad way.
Well, the myth of shooting down an airplane and then saluting it was utterly complete fiction. Reputation they had was that they would run. I said, I don't know whoever gave them that kind of reputation. But we had many fights with German fighters and others, and I never found one that was willing to turn around and run away from me anyway. In fact, it was just the other way.
They had impressed themselves very heavily on us. We were in a very bad shape when the Allied fighters came, and if they were not greenhorns, as fortunately it happened quite often, then they made very short shrift with us. People were shot down like flies. So that at the end of Flanders battle, I was the only survivor of my squadron, and I became acting squadron leader before I was 21 years old. It was enormously strenuous, and I think nobody would do it these days anymore. We flew sometimes 4 and 5 times in the night. In the meantime, downing 2 or 3 glasses of champagne and smoking a chain of cigarettes.
Well, dogfights were not, they were not regular. They were quite rare. I don't think they'd last more than 7 or 8 minutes.
Major Donald McLaren destroyed 48 German aircraft, many of them while flying a Sopwith Camel, like this one at the National War Museum in Ottawa. And of course, the greatest Allied ace of them all was another Canadian, the legendary Billy Bishop, a boyish face and a deadly competence. 72 kills.
There were thousands of less famous flyers, and the combination of their experiences would, in due time, have a profound effect on the air wars of the future.
The other dimension is in the complexity of role, because Canadians were not only significant as fighter pilots, although they made a disproportionate contribution, but in fact, Canadians made an even bigger contribution in bombing, in reconnaissance flying, in photography, in ground attack, in working with the artillery, which was a most significant and very difficult aspect of the air war.
we would get a photograph of that area where the target was. Then I would take it up, and from it I would know just where the target was, and I'd fly over the battery and give them a signal. As I knew the length of time it took the shell to travel from the muzzle of the gun to the target, when I noted where the shell fell, then the pilot would turn the machine around and head back towards the battery, and I would give them the correction. Then the battery would fire gun. At the flash of the gun, we would turn again. It meant doing a figure eight for 2.5 to 3 hours. Get most batteries registered. We were always scared. I never got into a machine when I wasn't scared.
Soldiers have been balancing fears since the dawn of time. But in this great war, for the first time, masses of civilians would come to know and share a life of terror.
Although all the powers had prepared themselves, they thought, for the air war, no one, not even the most sanguine military man, really fully envisaged what the impact of the air weapon was going to be on war. And by the end of the war, a number of men had come to the conclusion that the air weapon was so significant by itself that it conceivably, in the future, could win wars through massive bombing.
In the emotional heat of Germany in 1914, schoolchildren were being taught to sing Zeppelin flieg, hilf uns im Krieg, Zeppelin fly, help us in the war, all of England will be destroyed by fire. And not far from this spot on the embankment where I'm standing, that's almost exactly what happened. The heart of London, and that means the heart of England, was in flames.
The Zeppelin crews were termed baby killers in the British press. This was seen as deeply immoral, the bringing of warfare to innocent civilian populations.
I don't think there was ever an intention of bombing civilians deliberately. The inaccuracy of bombing, which of course was much more inaccurate in the First World War than in the Second, it just made it inevitable that a lot of civilians were killed.
The argument was that what was necessary was not outraged screams, but retaliation. That if someone, as George Orwell says, drops a bomb on your mother, your response is not outrage, but to drop two bombs on his mother.
I haven't found anything indicating that there are any moral scruples on the German side and on the Allied side. Of course, they're seething with indignation that they've been subject to this barbarous form of terroristic warfare, and they felt they had every right to get back.
It was that thinking which involved the British flying services in the first strategic bombing attack by aircraft against German cities, launched from bases in France and with squadron personnel who were 90% Canadian. So Canadians, right at the beginning of the strategic air offense against civilian centers, are involved. Admittedly, they're involved at the level of combatant and not at the level of policymaker. But we, as a people, have been involved in this great military fact of the 20th century right from its inception. Did the powers accept responsibility for this? They did, in a clear-eyed way. It came to be realized that in a war of totality, involving economies and whole peoples, that civilians were as open to attack as were the armies in the field.
November 1918. The planes and guns were silenced, and the 1st Canadian Air Force, which was formed at war's end, would soon be disbanded. So the boys would come home, some to fly again in the misty dawn of peace.
From the Wright brothers' first flight to the end of World War I was a scant 15 years, and perhaps nowhere else in human history has man shown such a black talent for taking a wonderful invention and turning it into an awesome vehicle of destruction. And yet, the experience had made Canada air-minded. It had taken a country and its people, launched them beyond their last frontier towards a new one.